François, you've been at the start of this earlier in your career, so what's your take?
Thank you, Patrick. I remember coming to Dubai in 95, 96 and building the first internet network and also building the first public access to Wi-Fi. When the Burj Al Arab was built, we installed the first modem on Yoko. And the reason was the room was so big, the value proposition was to keep your PC and go from one room to another. So very pleased to see the huge development of the Emirates and Dubai and Abu Dhabi. We've talked a lot about the space, but to better understand what's going on the space is important to understand what's going on down there on Earth. So I will spend a little time to explain what's going on. In fact, we have a correlation of two events which are totally non-correlated, who are changing the pace of the world. First, technology, and second, all the events, the war, the climate, the pandemic. But I'm not going to spend too much time on that because there is so many brilliant discussion on that. Technology is three things, in fact. It's hardware, and Geoffrey talk a little bit about that, then communication, and then software. For those who have gray hair like me, we've been grown up into the Moore's Law. The Moore's Law is you double the power of computers every 18 months. When you look at the chips now, the IoT, the storage, the edge computing, which is in the car, in the space, you were talking about the weight, Patrick, or the smartphone, now we're talking about multiply by 10 to 1 million within the next 8 years. So it's a total revolution. When you look at communication, evolution was 5G. You've heard about that. Revolution will be the next generation of 5G, where not only you will have speed and latency. Latency is will be divided by 100. Latency is the response time. You know when there is a false start at the 100 meters at the Olympics, if the runner starts before 10 milliseconds, then we consider that is a false start because the time for the body to process the information is about 10 milliseconds. Just as a reminder, when you listen to me, the speed of the sound goes to your ear at 340 meters per second. When you look at me, it's about 300 kilometers per second. So with the machine, we equal. We receive the information at the same speed. When the information goes into your ear, the speed is 100 meters per second. And when I touch this pen, I have sensors here. There is electricity going into my nerves, going to my, it's 60 meters per second. Then we not equal with the machine. So the third piece is algorithm. You have trillions of data, teraflops of data, how you make those data relevant. So there is an absolutely predicted revolution and trend of technology. At the same time, we had the pandemic, we had the war, and those were totally unpredicted events. So the mix of those two predicted trends and non-predicted have totally changed the way we live, the way the defense systems are organized, and is changing dramatically the state of the world. Personally, I've been in this business since 1977. I was very young, I started to program, and was very lucky to see the evolution of the technology. When I look at what Thierry de Montbriel has wrote, 15 years of reasonably open world, personally, my mission in life is to get everybody connected, because I consider that when you connect 7x24, on an ubiquitous way, everybody, then the equal access to connectivity is something very important. I speak about digital energy like food, gas, electricity, all the things that bring life. Then you have a topology issue. Do you continue to feed the overweight, like we do in some countries in the world, or do you give food to everybody? do you keep water wasted in many countries, or do you distribute the water? Is exactly the same with access to network. For me, it's very important that my mission in life, I just repeat it because it's my my energy from morning to tonight, is to help and contribute to distribute the signals to everybody. I give you a few examples because Patrick has asked me. 15 years ago, I was invited in Davos at a lunch with the government of Pakistan, and they want us to invest into a technology. And I say, Mr. Prime Minister, great country, but you have only one link, which is a submarine cable to the country. And one of these days, a fisherman will cut it. And he say, no, no, it's secure and whatever. So what I did, I put five big trucks, it's about $2 million a truck, with big antennas, just at the border of Pakistan waiting. 3 months after, I left my cards as a good sales guy. I got a call by the cabinet and say, Mr. Barrault, you were right, can you help? Of course. So my five trucks came to Pakistan, to the nodes, and in less than 24 hours, thanks to satellite, they could restore connectivity, because connectivity today is life. Of course, at this time, it was extremely expensive. Now, you know, there is a kind of pauperization of the satellite because of Constellation, because of Starlink, because now you have satellites on the roof of cars, and because companies like Eutelsat are going to launch a device at $300, $400, while Starlink is about $1,500. Another example also is when you have a crisis, a tsunami, a war, a pandemic, how do you send the signals? Because satellite, I really like Professor Suzuki what you said about 1-0, 2-0, and you had 3-0, so I will add 4-0. You know, there is a bid on the evolution. When you have a crisis, you have two ways to bring signals. Either you have fiber, either you have 4G, 5G. But if you are in the middle of nowhere, the only solution to get access down, upwards, downwards, is satellite. So as an example, when you have catastrophe, if you want to have a moving hospital, then you can bring low-weight satellite or cars to restore connectivity, and then to have the surgeon to operate sick people with a latency which is much better than human being, which I call the reflex. When I was CEO of British Telecom, I had created a huge rescue team that could operate anywhere in the world within 24 hours with planes, and it has helped a lot, you know, to connect the world, or hospitals, or back office, or logistic, you know, in less than 24 hours. So, to conclude, I think satellite is a fantastic opportunity, because we've moved from defense survey, and we had a very interesting video, to now giving access to everybody, and the solution will be a kind of hybridization between fiber, between 4G and 5G, and access to satellite. And maybe I will access to my dream that everybody in the planet will be connected, like water, food, and electricity. Thank you, Patrick.
Thank you, François. Yes, and unfortunately, with climate change, natural disaster management will probably be high on the agenda in the foreseeable future. And it's a very critical capacity, not only to manage the crisis, but to anticipate the crisis, and then to monitor how you recover from the crisis. So it's an application on Earth. Yeah. Okay. No. Good. So I've just been told for the audience, no Q&A. I hope you had a good overview of the problematic of space. I thank you for your participation, and please a round of applause for the panel, who brought all this expertise to you today. Thank you very much.